good morning.
Good morning.
Praise the Lord. Shalom. God is good. We're entering into another year where God is blessing us, and we're thanking Him for all the things that He's done, all the things that He's going to do, and the things He is yet doing for us right now. I thank God for His Word. His Word is so true. And as I was pondering upon this message today, one of the things that has just continued to keep going over and over and over in my mind, because we're going to talk about faith. And God is telling me that this year, 2017, you're going to need faith more than I think you've ever needed it before. Because I believe we're going to be subject to many challenges, things that are going to try to disrupt your faith in God. I think you're going to see things that you have not seen before. Not that you will be surprised by them, but I think these are things that are going to possibly touch you personally, that are going to cause you personally to begin to maybe doubt the very existence of God in your life. And I'm here today to give you a word that we have to learn how to live by faith. Seriously, live a life of faith. And I think one of the problems is that we want to use faith based upon a situation or a circumstance. Something happens, and then we have to use our faith in order to see ourselves through a particular situation or circumstance, when in actuality, every day you wake up, you ought to start to learn how to live that entire day walking in faith, irregardless of anything happens to you. You're going to have to learn how to trust God. You're going to have to learn how to step out in faith in areas that you haven't had to do that before. We cocoon ourselves sometimes with comforts or a comfort zone. This is where we live. We know how to handle this. I've done this before, so I know how to work this. I know how to work that. I know I can, you know, make it this way, or I can make it that way, but that's not living by faith. That's learning how to live by your wits and your understanding of the things you've done before, so that you think you can do it again. And I'm going to tell you, I'm a firm believer that you're going to be faced with some challenges you haven't had before.
Amen.
You may have seen other people have them. Other people may have gone through them, but these are going to touch you. And then what are you going to do? If you haven't been learning how to live by faith up until this point, when these things come, they're going to be putting on a floor show for you. They're going to become so mountainous. They're going to become so inundated with terror and horror. I ain't trying to scare you. I'm just trying to tell you the truth. Because I believe this year coming is going to really test the believer's faith in God. It's starting with us. Michelle and I are making some changes. And we have to trust God. And I don't know where God's going to take us, but I do trust Him that wherever He takes us, He's going to have our best interest at heart.
Amen.
And if He's going to do that for us, I guarantee you He's going to do it for you. So what is faith? You know, I think that's one of the questions that a lot of times we don't have a good, true answer to it. We know what the Bible says. We struggle a lot of times how to explain faith, because faith does not have a physical form. It's not tangible or incapable of being perceived, especially by the senses or by touch. You can't see faith. We are a tangible society. We are tangible beings. We like to touch something. We like to have a visual acuity of something. We want to be able to see it. We want to be able to hear it. We want to be able to taste it. We got to touch it. You know, if it's not that, then sometimes we struggle with belief. And you can't operate that. Faith exists and is paramount in its importance to our relationship with God. It's paramount. It has to be. You cannot operate in God without it. And I'm going to tell you, believer, if you're going to call yourself a believer, you better start believing. We're in a war. We are in a war. We are in a war for our very existence. I'm here to tell you. We really are. The last 4 months of 2016 ought to prove some things to you.
Amen.
Because 2017 is already starting out with a bang.
Yep.
And I guarantee you, without having that faith in God, you're going to find yourself swimming in a sea of mess.
Amen.
And I don't plan to swim in nobody's sea of mess.
Amen.
I don't want you all to swim in a sea of mess. You better start trusting and believing in God. Hebrews 11:6 in the New King James says, without faith, it is impossible to please him. Without faith, you cannot please God. For he who comes to God must first believe that he is. You've got to believe in the existence of God, not part-time, not sometimes, not only when it meets your criteria of who you want to call upon when you're in trouble, but know that even if you don't have a problem, God exists. And that he is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. I like that word, diligent. You can't look for God just in certain situations and circumstances. You got to look for God all the time in everything.
Amen.
You have to see him in the bad just as well as you see him in the good.
Yep.
God is everywhere. He knows everything. He knows everyone. He is everything. Every hair on your head is numbered. He knows the ones that you will grow naturally. He knows the ones you bought. Oh, I ain't playing.
Uh-oh.
I'd have gone to bed and now heaven.
Yes.
That's all right. It's still the truth anyhow. He knows everything. We think we can pull the wool over his eyes. We know that we sometimes think he ain't looking at us. We want to do certain things or act certain ways or say certain things. And then afterwards it's like, oh, well, maybe God. No, he knew what you were thinking before you thought it.
Amen.
He knew what you were going to say before you said it. So you better start believing in him and trusting him that he knows more about you than you do. He knows more about where you're going than you're going. He knows the way you need to take before you even think about picking up a map. He's God. We have to learn how to live a life of faith. Trusting and believing God. With it, we're able to overcome every obstacle that is in our lives. Matthew 17:20 in the New Revised Standard Version says, he said to them, because of your little faith. We're talking about a man who had a son who was full of demonic spirits. Goes on to say that sometimes the spirits would, you know, throw the boy down, throw him in the fire, throw him in the water, try to kill him. The father brought the child to the disciples, and the disciples couldn't do anything for the son. So the father goes to Jesus. In essence, he's saying, if you can do anything, help my son. Jesus turns around and says, what do you mean if I can do anything? If you can believe. All things are possible to him who believes. After he healed the little boy, after he chased away the demons, the disciples came to them and came to Jesus and asked, well, how come we couldn't do it? Because you got little faith. For I tell you this, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will be able to say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move and nothing will be impossible to you. Now, was Jesus talking figuratively or literally? The answer is yes. Some of us have some mountains in our lives that you look at it and there is no way possible that you think you can get over it.
Amen.
Some of these situations in our lives are so huge. They're bearing down on us. We can't sleep at night. We wake up in the morning and that's the first thing that's on our minds. How am I going to make it? What am I going to do? How is this happening to me? That's figurative, not literal. Some of us have got some mountainous health issues. Some of us have got some mountainous debt. Oh yeah. Some of us have got some stuff that is so hard and heavy physically that you can't get through it. But he's telling you, if you got faith the size of a mustard seed, not talking about its itty bitty girth, but its potency. The Bible goes on to talk about that mustard seed. It says that even though it is one of the smallest seeds you can find, when it is planted and it grows into such a magnanimous thing that birds make their nest in the bush. Have a little bitty seed. Anybody ever seen an acorn? What's that turn into?
An oak tree.
One of the strongest, biggest trees that are out there.
Mm-hmm.
An oak tree from a mighty little small seed. So where's your faith? What is it? It's not about the girth of it, but its potency. Knowing that you can see every situation and through God's eyes see beyond the problem and already see the victory. That's what we're talking about. That's how you live by faith, by every single day waking up and knowing that today, Lord, no matter what happens, no matter what comes, whether it's good or whether it's bad, I believe you and I trust you with my life.
Amen.
Because without that, I guarantee you, you're walking blindly. And today is not a day to walk in blindness.
No.
The enemy's just waiting to trip you up. He cannot wait for you to walk into his sphere blind. Because I guarantee you, he's going to introduce something to your life that is going to totally disrupt your whole livelihood. That's what's about to happen, I guarantee you. So the Greek, let's see, and be victorious in every situation that the enemy comes against us with. Found in 1 John 5 and 4 and Amplified. It says, for everyone born of God is victorious and overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has conquered and overcome the world. Our continuing, persistent faith in Jesus, the Son of God. Continuing, persistent faith. You can't have faith today and don't have faith tomorrow.
Amen.
You can't have faith this morning and don't have it this afternoon. Some of you will probably walk out of here this morning on fire with the glory. As soon as you get home, you may get a phone call. Or, I'm sorry, a text.
Text.
Millennials don't know nothing about phone calls. They only know about texts. That will disrupt your day. Then what you're going to do? You're going to succumb to maybe bad news or succumb to things that's going to change your way, or you're going to remember that if you have continuing, persistent faith in God, you can conquer and overcome the world, the situations, the circumstances. That's what we're talking about. You're going to be tested. You're going to be tried. Opportunities are going to come your way, and you're going to want to maybe sometimes throw a fleece before the Lord like Gideon did. Lord, is it you? I did that before. I don't do that no more. God already showed me he's real and he's true and that he means what he says. I don't have to test him. He means what he says. So if he tells you to walk out in faith, you better walk out in faith and you better trust and believe what he says. The Greek translation of the word faith is pistis. Pistis. It means to persuade. It means credence, yielding, conviction, assurance, belief, fidelity, and confidence. These are the things that are listed up under that word faith. You have to be able to know that God is giving you substantial proof of his existence and of the things that he says he will do for you. God's never going to tell you he's going to do something for you and he don't do it. God is not a man that he should lie. He's never lied. He's incapable of lying. I heard somebody say once, even if he tried to lie, whatever came out of his mouth would be the truth before, before it would even change. He's incapable of telling a lie. So if he's telling you that you need to have assurance, belief, fidelity, and confidence in him, he means every bit of it. And you don't have to worry about the outcome of any situation because he already knows what he's going to do and how he's going to do it and why he's going to do it. Romans 8, 38 through 39 in the Living Bible says, "For I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from his love." Nothing. I've heard too many believers try to say, "God don't love me," or "I don't feel God loves me," or "I don't feel God's presence. God don't love me no more." That's a lie. That's a lie from the devil all day long. I'm persuaded nothing will ever separate us from God's love. I don't care how bad you are. I don't care what you've done. He'll never stop loving you. Death can't. Life can't. The angels won't. All the powers of hell itself cannot keep God's love away. Nothing. Our fears for today, our worries about tomorrow, or where we are high above the sky or in the deepest ocean, nothing will ever be able to separate us from the love of God demonstrated by our Lord Jesus when he died for us. Nothing. Do you understand this? Nothing will ever separate you from God's love. He'll never stop loving you. Problem is, we stop loving God. Amen. We turn our backs on him. We stop doing his bidding and start doing our own because we're comfortable with making our own decisions instead of relying upon God's word to be our guide. And anytime you do that, I guarantee you, you're fighting yourself in bad situation. Amen. In the midst of what seemed to be impossible or insurmountable situations with no way out, our faith comforts us in the knowledge that our God will deliver us. And you've got to really see that. You've got to really feel that. That no matter what, God's going to deliver you. God's going to be there for you. He's going to see you through every situation and every circumstance. 2 Timothy 4 and 18 in the New King James says, "And the Lord will deliver me from every evil work and preserve me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen." He's going to deliver me from every evil work. The enemy's got plans for you. He's got plots and ploys already set out for you. Don't be deceived. Don't think the enemy is not trying to destroy you. The Bible says he is going around as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. He has not stopped his pursuit towards you. But God will deliver you from every evil plot, every evil ploy, every evil person, every evil spirit, every evil situation that finds itself that's got your name on it. I'm a firm believer that he's going to do that. Why? Because that's what his word says. He's going to preserve you for his heavenly kingdom. He knows your name. We sang that song. He knows your name. He knows your name. Guarantee you, he gave it to you before your mama thought about it. God knows you. Faith is living as if it were so, even when it appears not to be so, in order for it to be so, because it is so. Amen. Based on the word of God. You gotta live as though it's already done.
Come on, man. Amen.
Even when you don't see the outcome, yes. you still have got to live as though God has already blessed you.
Yes.
That's why we praise him even in the midst of our situations and circumstances. That's why we worship him even when things look bad. That's why we trust him. We follow his directions in order for it to be so. Because it doesn't appear that it's going to be so.
Right.
It appears like it's going to be the worst thing that's ever happened to you in your life. But in order for it to be so, you've got to have that faith. You've got to live that way. Because it's all based on God's word. We've been reading it so far this day. And nothing's going to ever separate us from his love. And if he loves you, he will take care of you. If he loves you, he's going to fulfill in you all the things he has for you. Faith is the unquestioning belief in God and in the word of God. Faith is basic to our salvation. We did a series on salvation, and I guarantee you I'm going back to that. There's one thing that I understand and know about salvation is just because you get saved doesn't mean you don't continue to need to be saved.
Amen.
We think we got saved and now everything is cool. I can do whatever I want. No, it doesn't work that way. Because many times we fall. Many times we slip. Many times our faith wavers and we need to be delivered again. We need to be saved out of the hands of the enemy. So it's so important and it's so basic to our salvation in God so that we can continue to walk. See, desire is here. But the object of our desire is over there. Does that make sense? What you believe, your desire, what you want, right there. But the object of it is not within your view yet. You have to sometimes paint it on the canvas of your mind and on your imagination so that you know that where it is needs to become a part of you.
Amen.
What you want right now may not always be here right now, but I guarantee you it's coming. Because all you got to do is have faith and believe and trust
in
God.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
He's got something for you. It's got your name on it. Yeah. It don't have anybody else's name on it. It's yours. And he wants you to feel it, see it, understand it, and believe it.
Thank you.
Expectation goes beyond desire. Although we have desire, we got to understand that without desire, there is no faith. You got to have it. It reaches from what is not to what is. I'm trying to get you to understand about faith. What you're going to need in order to make it through this year. Expectation, faith, it's anticipation. We just come through the holiday season, and I think one of the greatest examples is going to be our children. They can't wait till Christmas Day. They've been told you got to be good. You have good grades in school. You got to follow mom and daddy's directions. You got to do this, got to do that. And Christmas Eve, I think sometimes is the hardest time for a child because they're just like, I can't wait. Hardest thing to do is get a child to bed on Christmas Eve.
Amen.
You gotta go sleep. I can't wait. They're laying in bed going, ooh, man, it's gonna be able to put that tree. Ooh. Can't wait. That's anticipation. They're already anticipating what they're gonna get. Child of God, you ought to have that same type of energy in you and God. Ooh, I can't wait to see what God's about to do. I know that's how Michelle and I are about this church. We can't wait to see what God's getting ready to do because he's getting ready to do some crazy, off-the-chain things, and I know it's going to be good.
Amen.
Because I don't think like that. It's not my mind. It's the mind of God.
Amen.
And I want what he wants. I don't want what I want.
Amen.
I want what he wants. And he's going to take us where he wants us to go. He's going to bring into here the things that are needed in here to meet your every need so that you can give the word of God away. There are those that are in need of the word of God through you. But you can't give it if you don't believe. If you don't believe it yourself, how can you give it to somebody else? If you can't walk in it, how can you expect somebody else to? We got family members don't know nothing about God. Amen. Or know about God, don't want nothing to do with God. You got to change that attitude. Because what you're about to see in the world this year, honestly, I ought to scare them to the church. It really should. Because I'm going to tell you, the devil's already, he's already got it all masked up, painted up, got a pretty bow on it, trying to make it so pleasing to the eye and the ear and the senses. But in the core of it, it is deadly poison, and it will kill you if you touch it. Guaranteed. Desire wants something. Expectation looks for something. Hope wants and looks for something. You need to have hope. Now, hope is not faith. They're different. But you gotta have hope. You gotta look beyond what you think you see in the media. You have to look beyond what you hear on the radio or, you know, on the internet. You gotta look beyond that. You got to see that there is a hope in God that goes beyond that stuff. And know as a child of God that he's going to take care of you. I don't care what the world does. That doesn't matter how they think, how they want to act, what they want to introduce. You got spirits that you got to fight. And I personally don't care if I take a hit or miss or not. I don't care. Kim Burrell, may I understand what happened with her? She's a gospel singer, and she's the pastor of a church.
Oh, yeah.
And she stood up, and she was preaching a sermon, and she talked about homosexuality. She used some words that, you know, she felt to use. Not everybody would use those words, but I personally believe that what she said is truth, because it is an abomination to God.
Amen.
Word of God.
It is.
Yes, it is.
But just like I've told you all before too, and I say it to myself, it's not the person, it's the spirit. Mm-hmm. And I do believe that we as children of God are fighting the wrong way. We keep talking about the people. It ain't Ellen. It ain't nothing. It don't matter who the person is. It's the spirit. Mm-hmm. And we have to fight the spirit of homosexuality because it's infecting our children. And if the whole world turns to homosexuality, there ain't going to be no more children born.
That's right.
Amen.
Boom,
there it is.
Boom, there it is. See, these are things that the enemy wants to try to paint a glorious picture to make it all okay. To make it all right. But that ain't just homosexuality. It's anything else that we do that is sinful to God.
Yes.
Stealing. Adultery. Drug addiction. Anything we do that is against the word of God is just as bad as the other. To God, sin is sin is sin is sin. And he abhors all of it. So if you think we're just attacking one group of people, I ain't attacking nobody. I'm talking the spirit. I love everybody. I want everybody to come through this door.
Amen.
And I won't turn nobody. I ain't going to talk about nobody, but I'm sure I'm going to talk about the spirits that infect us all, that try to turn us all around and try to hurt and harm each and every one of us. And if we can't fight against that as God's people, then we're not armed as we should be.
Amen.
And God has given us all the spiritual armor you're ever going to need to fight every spirit that comes your way. There was a time when Michelle and I had some financial problems. I had a cleaning service, I had a cleaning business. And for about 3 years, I struggled real bad. That put us into a real bad situation. I wasn't saved when I started it. I sure got saved in the middle of it. And I had to learn how to depend upon God. We went into some bad financial situations. We almost lost our home. So many things happened to us. And we had to learn how to trust and depend upon God. And this is one of the strict scriptures that really helped us get over the thought of allowing the enemy to destroy us. He says in Philippians 4:19 in the New Revised Standard Version, "And my God will fully satisfy every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus." And you need to understand something. He has the ability to fulfill every one of your needs according to his riches in Christ Jesus. And what does God own?
Everything.
What does God own?
Everything.
So if he owns everything and it's according to his riches, guess what? He's never going to shortchange your needs.
Amen.
He's never going to see you. David said it best, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." I'm here to tell you, child of God, God does not want you to want for anything. Your needs are to be met according to his riches. We had to depend upon that. And we watched God cook. Jesus. We watched him cook when we started to really depend upon him. And he hasn't stopped since. He took us out of receivership for our business. He took us out of the bankruptcy from our house. The house is still here. It ain't our house no more. It ain't even the bank's house no more. It's God's house.
Amen.
Since we've dedicated our lives to him, we've watched him do nothing but continue to bless us and take us forward. And he ain't done yet. He ain't done. He ain't gonna be done. We're gonna continue to walk in him. And guess what, honey? If he do it for me, he'll do it for you. Michelle and I are nobody special. We're just ones who have learned how to yield our will to God. And if we can do that, you can do that. And if you can do that, you can surely show others how they can too. The just shall live by faith. All down through scripture. I had to start looking at this. Because I found that there are many scriptures in here to tell you about the just living by faith. Again, not just living by circumstance. When something happens or a situation happens, you have to live your life by faith. Found this in Habakkuk 2 and 4. "Behold the proud, his soul is not upright in him, but the just shall live by faith." This is scripture. Romans 1:17, "For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith." That seems like this is a pattern, isn't it? Galatians 3:11, "But that no one is justified by the law in the sight of God is evident, for the just shall live by faith." Hebrews 10:38, "Now the just shall live by faith." Do you think I just brought this up as a subject that I wanted to preach about? No. God's telling me you got to learn how to live by faith. Every day. Always. I guarantee you, when you start to learn to live by faith, watch your life change. Watch God start to open up all avenues and areas in your life that you didn't think were possible. Watch God turn things around for you. Doesn't mean the enemy's not going to come, but I guarantee you, when he comes, he's going to find a stone wall. Bang! An impregnable force. Can't get through. Boom. Bump his head. Boom. I guarantee you, this is what this is about. I'm not saying it. You found this in four different spots, that the just shall live by faith. The word of God makes it clear that the commencement, continuation, and completion of a Christian life is by faith. God's promises and all that a Christian can ever hope to accomplish, attain, or become cannot be realized apart from faith.
Amen.
Whatever you ever want in this life, we're not talking about going to heaven yet. I'm talking about how you live right here on this earth. You can never hope to accomplish anything without faith in God. You can't attain the things God has for you without faith in God. You can't become the things you want in this life to become without faith in God. God is trying to tell you something today. God's trying to tell me something today. I got to learn how to live by faith.
Amen.
It's not automatic. You got to learn it. Every day you have to trust Him. I remember as a child, we lived out in the country, and a friend of mine, there was a big woods behind his house. And it was the first time I had, you know, a young teenager, you know, in the wintertime, we walking out through the woods, you know, and we would come across little areas of ice where like it had rained and it, you know, wasn't big, but it was just these little pockets all over the ground of ice. And you had to learn how to test them. Put your foot on there. Try to give a little bit of extra weight, a little bit more, see if it was something you could cross over. Mm-hmm. If you heard that first crack, you need to back up off that bad boy. If you didn't hear no crack, then you went out a little further. Test it a little bit more. You get your whole foot on there, you didn't hear nothing. You bear down a little bit, took a little bit more of your weight. Then after all that, you stand on it. And it's solid. But you had to learn how to test it every bit. God is telling you, you got to learn how to walk this walk of faith. Sometimes you have to step on it a little bit. Put a little weight on it. Get in the midst of it and realize that God is there holding you up. Giving you all the support you ever need to walk this walk. To make it through. He's holding you up. Then you realize, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I got your best interest at heart. I got you. I got you. You can make it. That's what we do. That's how we learn to live a life of faith. I encourage you today, step out on God a little more and watch God do things for you that will bless you. Every day you wake up, you have to ask God, Father, as I step out in faith on you today, before I even get out of my bed, I'm going to trust you to lead me where you want me to go. And then you start walking in that direction. Listen for his voice. Cleanse yourself from all unrighteousness. We all have sinned. We all have done things and said things that we know are definitely not according to what God does. So I even ask God, Father, forgive me of my unrighteousness. Cleanse me so that you can hear me. Your word has said that if I regard iniquity in my heart, you won't hear me. I need you to hear me. I'm talking to you. I need you to hear me today. Cleanse me so that I know I can only know that you're hearing me, but that I can hear you too.
Amen.
Turn my radio frequency to that dial to when you're talking, I know that you're talking to me. And we learn to live a life of faith. Amen.
Amen.
God is good. We thank God today. I thank Him for His blessings. I thank Him for the strength that He continues to give us every day as we walk this walk in Him. We want to continue to do that. I encourage you to bless somebody. I want to thank you for watching this video. I pray that you are blessed by it, that it encourages you to have a deeper relationship with God, that you continue to fight a good fight of faith and grow strong and courageous in your daily battles with the enemy. I encourage you to subscribe to this page, like us on Facebook, and log on to our website. There you can submit a prayer request and support this ministry through a financial gift. And remember, if each one can reach one, and a reached one can reach one, then a one will have one, and the kingdom will have been advanced one soul at a time. Thank you again, and God bless you.